Okay, we're going to start in 8 minutes, but if you're standing, there's seats upstairs. So just go up the stairs. There's more seats upstairs. Don't stand around. Go upstairs. Not yet, we're going to start in 8 minutes. Yes, there's lots of room upstairs. We're going to start in 2 minutes. Yeah, keep it there. Look at the iPad. Just look. Okay. Oh, right. Hey, people. Okay, so there's lots of room upstairs. If anyone doesn't have a seat up there, go upstairs. Hello, everyone. Hey. Okay, so lots of room upstairs. Okay, so we're about to begin. I want to ask, does anyone know or have anyone ever been in a UX Salon event before? I'm here. Or who hasn't been before? Okay, lots of people. Okay, so let me explain shortly what is a salon before we begin. Okay, so a salon, a UX salon, is basically a talk plus discussion. What I mean is that I wanted to create an event that's not just like presentation and then you go home. It's actually an event where you see a presentation. Today we're going to see two presentations, and then we're going to stay and talk about it, discuss. If anyone wants to come up here and say something, if anyone wants to ask a question or add to the conversation, feel free. It's a salon conversation. And this is what this UX Salon is all about. And usually we do an event every month or so. So this is something traditional I want to do every time, every event, because people come here to learn, but they also come here to network and find jobs. A lot of people are looking for jobs, but is anyone in the crowd looking to hire? Yeah. Where? Here. Wait a minute. Okay. Where? Okay. Yes. What are you looking for? Digital marketing specialist? For cybersecurity company. What's your name? Vicky. Vicky, okay. So come to the door at the end if anyone was looking for you, looking for Vicky. Okay, anyone else here looking to hire? Yes, you. What's your name? Ishai, okay.
Trucks, and we're looking for around three years experience, user experience specialist.
Okay, someone has 3 years experience?
About 3 years.
Okay, so come to Ishai. Anyone else?
I'm not here, finally, from here, full time.
Okay, so at the end, if anyone wants to talk to you, again, more. More people.
Here.
Okay, here.
UI, UX, 2 years.
2 years experience, full time?
Some experience.
Okay, what's your name?
Ari.
Ali?
Ari.
Adi.
Ariadna.
Okay, Ariadna. So come here at the end of to the door.
And marketing.
And marketing. Okay, cool. So, last chance. Because this is an opportunity. If you guys see these people after, talk to them. Maybe there's a good connection here. Okay. That's it? Okay.
And also, I wanted to say to you that as a UX Salon, I have a page, uxsalon.com/jobs. If you're looking for a job, send me your resume. I like to make these connections. If you're looking to hire, or if you're not looking for any jobs, you're working right now, but you want to receive offers from time to time. Once a month, we're going to send like hot jobs, like really good quality jobs. So just sign up to this list, and it's completely anonymous. You're going to get an email once a month with like really good jobs. So maybe you want to change your position. It's a great place to come. So I want to tell you a little bit about the coming in 2 weeks UX Salon Conference 2019. So let's begin with this. Something I'm very proud of. I directed, shot, and traveled the world for this movie. 1 minute. Okay, that was fun. So basically, experience is everywhere, and I wanted to create a conference. This year's conference is about like experiences beyond the screen. And I tried to go with that theme because to kind of learn what's behind what we do, what motivates us to do what we do, and how can we do our job better. So I invited, so as you can see here in this, it's a conference, usually 700 people come, it's a full day. Event, international, mostly I try to get a lot of speakers from outside of Israel to come, and I'm going to share, the host is Vitaly Friedman, who is the Smashing Magazine co-host. He's a great guy, he's a great designer, he's coming to host the conference, so it's a professional host, and I want to share with you some of the talks. I invited Matthew Bennett is the lead sound designer for Microsoft. He's responsible for all the sounds we hear from Microsoft. He's going to talk to us about how to design beyond the screen, like how do sounds emotion. And right after his talk, I also invited Connor, who is the sound lead designer for Google. Both of them design sound that millions of people hear. And we're going to talk about sensory design and the future of sensory design and how to create product sounds. Next, Marie, she's coming to speak about inclusive design. She has a very unique perspective because she's deaf. So she's going to share with us how she's designing for a bank in Amsterdam as a deaf person. Usually we forget designing. We kind of ignore this population of people over 50. And these are the most richest people in the world. It's a population we never consider in our thoughts. So Rina Naor is a researcher in this field, and she's going to come and tell us how to design for people who are growing up, for grown-ups. I invited for the lunch break. It's going to be some performances. These are really cool tools. They're going to perform and explain to us how they work with these music tools. So this is going to be during lunch. Ellie Vogel, she's going to come to speak about practical machine learning. How do we use machine learning for user experience design? Memories. How do we shape memories in user experience design? And also, how do we understand what people feel while they use our apps or websites? If we can analyze how they feel, maybe we can create better memories. So this is a new research. She's going to come up for this. And Benjamin Hirsch is a product designer at Dropbox.com, formerly very senior in Medium.com. And he's going to talk to us about how to craft products. If the product is the writing is the product, when copy becomes design. Okay, so this was in short. There's more than this, but this was in short. If you want, go to 2019.uxsalon.com and check out all the talks. Okay, and now a short exercise. Please take out your phone, if you can. Does anyone have a phone here? Okay, So please come to, turn on to Instagram, because we're going to try to do something fun right now. Go to Instagram and look for UX Salon. Because while you do that, I'm going to tell you, UX Salon is a place where I share constantly about the events. So if you never want to miss an event from UX Salon, if you want to see behind the scenes, if you want to get inspired, like this weekend I did this brief story presentation where I summarized a concept into a story. So every weekend I'll try to do that, a short presentation on your story on Instagram. So please follow Instagram, follow UX Salon on Instagram. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a chance to win a ticket to the conference. So I'm going to take a photo of everyone here. And let's try this. Okay. So everyone, raise your hands in the air. Okay, I'll do the upstairs. 1 second. Now it's so slow. Okay, upstairs. So I'm going to publish this photo into the Instagram. If you see this photo, please comment. Tell us why you want to come to the conference. I'm going to take two tickets and give it to randomly to people who just, or maybe a reply that I really like. So it's a chance to win. Okay, so do it. I'll do it in a bit while the presentations are going. And if you want, I have by this Friday, if you really want to come to the conference as well, if you can't afford it, if your boss is not letting you go, apply for a discount, uxsalon.com/ilaveux. By Friday, I'll see all the responses, and I can give 5 tickets at a really good discount. So if you really want to come, go to uxsalon.com/ilaveux, put in your name, and you may get a good discount. So just tell me why. So that's it for me. Now we're going to our first presentation. So Yael, I invite you up. It's going to be a little weird because Yael is going to speak in Hebrew. Yes. But the presentation after that, we're going to get it in English because it takes time to prepare a presentation. And I asked very short. So thank you for agreeing to this. Yael is going to talk to us about how we can use humor in user experience design. Am I right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you want a hand microphone, or do you want this?
I don't mind.
Okay, I can give you this. Yeah. Okay, so let's go for this microphone. One. This is the clicker?
היי. יא. טוב, כיף להיות פה. אז אני יעל, והיום אני אדבר על הומור בחוויית משתמש. קצת עליי. התחלתי בתור ויז'ואל דיזיינר, סיימתי חולון, עבדתי כמה שנים בתחום של טלוויזיה, עבדתי בערוץ 10, ואז התעורר בי איזה חוסר סביעות רצון כזה בנוגע להגדרת המקצוע. חיפשתי איזה הרחבה. רציתי לעשות משהו עם יותר משמעות. למדתי תואר שני בטכניון, בעיצוב תעשייתי, ותעסקתי שם בהנדסת אנוש, במחקר, ובעצם מאז עשיתי את ההרחבה הזאת של לעסוק בעיצוב ואפיון באופן משולב. עבדתי בחברות מוצר, חברות פרויקטים, והיום אני עובדת בפיליפס הלטקר כמעצבת מאפיינת. אז היום באתי לדבר על הומור, ולדבר על הומור זה לא תמיד מצחיק, אבל אני אשתדל שזה יהיה מעניין. נתחיל ככה טיפה מלדבר על מה זה הומור, כי זה מושג יותר כזה מופשט בתיאוריה. די מהר אני אעבור לממשקים, למה כדאי לנו לעשות בהם הומור, ואיך נעשה את זה נכון. יאללה, מתחילים. Texting another mom. I'm done. I'm selling my kid on eBay. Don't be silly. You made him. Put him on Etsy. אז כשאנחנו חושבים על הומור, האינטואיציה אולי תוליך אותנו שולה לחשוב שמדובר באיזה תופעה ספונטנית, ככה לא מתוכננת, מורבים פה יצרים, אבל טוויסט בעלילה, יש מודל תפיסה מסודר שמתאר את התהליך, וזה מתחיל באיזה גירוי תפיסתי, כמו האימא שרוצה למכור את מחמל נפשה באי-ביי, מה שגורם לנו לחשוב, להעלות ככה כל מיני ספקולציות בראש, מה תענה לאימא השנייה, מה יהיה פה הפאנצ'ליין. אם לא הופתענו, לא צחקנו, ולמעשה הבדיחה נכשלה. אבל אם הופתענו, אנחנו ננסה להבין את הלוגיקה, מה הייתה החוקיות בבדיחה. להבין בדיחה, קצת כמו לפתור בעיה. לא הבנתי. מה לי ולאתרי אונליין שופינג? או שאין לי ילדים, או שיש לי ילדים, אבל למה למכור אותם? הורות זו שלמות. יכול להיות שזה לא עבד עבורי. אבל אם הבנתי, אותגרתי והופתעתי, בינגו. אני אגיב איפשהו ברצף שבין חיוך שבלב לצחוק מתגלגל. הצחוק הוא בעצם התגמול שלנו על העבודה המלוכלכת שהמוח שלנו עשה. במעבר חד למוצרים, אם המוצר שלנו הוא פונקציונלי, אמין ושמיש, אז אנחנו נתפנה להתעסק בשכבה העליונה הזאת של תרצו ההגשמה העצמית של המוצר, ההנאה ממוצרים. הומור הוא אחד האמצעים החזקים ביותר ל-emotional design, בכוחו לייצר את אותו קשר רגשי שאנחנו כל כך שואפים להשיג מהמשתמשים שלנו. תנסו להיזכר בפרסומת הראשונה שאי פעם בחיים ראיתם. אני קצת עתיקה, אז בשבילי זה מילקי, שנות ה-80, קריסטל ואלקסיס, הגרסה הישראלית באיזה קאטפייט מטורף על המילקי האחרון במדף. יכול להיות שהיום זה לא היה מצחיק אותי, בזמנו זה היה היסטרי. מחקרים שעשו בתחום של אסטרטגיה בפרסום, נמצא בהם שאם נעשה שימוש בהומור בנרטיב של הפרסומת, היא תיזכר לטווח הארוך בהשוואה לפרסומת בלא נעשה שימוש בהומור. זה ממצא שנמצא נכון גם במחקרים שנעשו בחוויית משתמש. אני אתחיל עכשיו טיפה להריץ דוגמאות. או שלא. Webflow, כלי ליצירת פרוטוטייפינג. תראו איך הם עושים שימוש בחלק הריק בממשק, לגרום למשתמשים שלהם ללמוד, לזכור ולהבין את המיקום של הכפתור המרכזי בממשק. יתרון נוסף, טיימהופ, שזאת קפסולת הזמן של התמונות שלנו. אם נגלול לסוף הפיד שלהם, יחשפו בפנינו התחתונים של הדינו שלהם, ואנחנו נחווה באיזה סוג של הנאה כזאת, את ההבנה שהגענו בעצם לסוף. שזה דבר שיכול היה להיות כאילו חוויה טיפה חמוצה. מכירים את זה שאתם משתפים מסך? מכירים את זה שאתם משתפים מסך, ובדיוק באותם רגעים, uninvited, מופיעות כל אותן הסכות, מביכות, פרטיות. אז מה זה לו מוצר שבא לתת מענה בדיוק על זה? בהום פייג' שלהם הם נותנים לנו פה את קומדיית הטעויות במלוא תפארתה. מצד אחד, הלוגו שלהם מנסה לנבוח עלינו, מהצד השני, נוטיפיקציות כאלה חסרות טקט, צצות בזו אחר זו, והן משכנעות אותי טוב טוב שכדאי. רידמי הוא האב למפתחים, והם לקחו את ההומור, והם בעצם תפסו פה נורא, בצורה נורא מדויקת את הצורך של המשתמשים בדיסקרטיות בנוגע לסיסמה שלהם, וזה הומור שמקנה ככה פרספקטיבה ומוטיבציה חיובית למילוי המשימה. מיילצ'ימפ היא אולי הדוגמה המוכרת ביותר ובצדק לבויס אנד טון מהודק שמלא הומור שכתוב בצורה ממש ככה מושלמת בכל מפגש של המשתמש עם המערכת. קליפורד נאס שחקר רבות את הקשר בין בני אדם לבין המכשירים שלנו, אחת המסקנות הנהדרות שלו הייתה שאם המכשירים שלנו ידברו אלינו בהומור, אנחנו נחזיר להם אהבה. והנה, בהודעת השגיאה נכתב לי ששם המשתמש כבר קיים, ואולי זה התאום השטן שלי, אז אני אגיב בחיוך ואני אסלח למערכת על המגבלות שלה. צילה דיבי, סטארט-אפ מתחום הדאטאבייסז, זה מתוך פרויקט שאני הצבתי שנה שעברה בקוד ואליו. הסיטואציה מתוארת, המערכת איננה תומכת במובייל, אז סילה, שהיא בעצם מפלצת ים שיצר להם אולג מילשטיין, היא מביטה פה בבוז בשלולית העלובה שלה במובייל ומסבירה למשתמש, קטן מדי, לא יעבוד. אונבורדינג תהליך מעיק, ששנו על משתמשים. טייפפורם, נותנים למשתמשים שלהם, זו מערכת להכנת טפסים, נותנים למשתמשים שלהם כבר להכין את כל הטופס, ורק כשממש אין ברירה, ההיפסטר החביב שלהם מפנה אותנו בכן להרשמה. GTP היא מערכת הזמנות של סוכני נסיעות, זה עוד פרויקט ממקום עבודתי הקודם, מקוד וליו. דנה פרויד יצרה להם את מושיק, שממלא בכן את כל מצבי האפס במערכת, והנה סיימנו להזמין לנוסע שלנו טיסה, מושיק נוחת לנו מובטל על הספסל, אולי נזמין לו מלון, ומורות שבעצם מניע לפעולה. בטרלו, אפליקציה לניהול פרויקטים, ליצירת כרטיסיות משימה, משתמשים בכלבלב שלהם, בפוזיציה באמת הכי נוגעת ללב, שעושה לי חשק לענות לבקשה, לדרג את האפליקציה, לשתף חברים. דן ספר, בספרו מיקרו-אינטראקשנס, קרא בדיוק לרגעים האלו, סיגנצ'ר מומנטס. אלו רגעים שבמקום שהמשתמשים שלנו יחוו איזה תסכול או אכזבה, בכוחנו להפוך את היוצרות ולגרום להם לזכור את האינטראקציה לחיוב. אז למה כדאי לנו להשתמש בהומור? כי הוא יגרום למשתמשים שלנו לזכור, להבין וללמוד דברים שקשורים בממשק, הוא מביא איתו איזה סלחנות, מקליל עבורם תהליכים מעיקים, הוא יכול לגרום למשתמשים שלנו לאהוב את המוצר שלנו, אולי אפילו את עצמם, והוא גורם להם להיות יותר אקטיביים בממשק, הרבה פעמים לשם אנחנו שואפים. הסעיף האחרון נוגע טיפה לעבודת הצוות, למאחורי הקלעים. ישנו גוף מחקר נכבד שעוסק בחלקו הדיל ברייקרי של הומור בהנעת תהליכים יצירתיים בעבודת צוות. נמצא שאם נדע להשתמש בהומור בדיוק ברגעים האלו שאנחנו חווים איזה תקיעות, זה עשוי להיות ממש פריצת הדרך שלנו לאיזה תוצר יותר קריאטיבי. אז סיכמנו שהומור זה אחלה, בואו נדבר קצת על איך לעשות את זה, נעשה את זה באמצעות 4 שאלות שאני מיד יתחיל להדגים, נשאל האם הוא מתאים למשתמשים, האם הוא משרת את החוויה, האם הוא מתאים למוצר, והאם הוא מוסיף לי משהו. דרך חביבה לזכור זאת, זכרו כי הומור מחמם את הלב, משתמשים, חוויה, מוצר, מוסיף. אז לגבי המשתמשים. אני אשתדל לזכור. אז לגבי המשתמשים. אז אנחנו צריכים תמיד להבין, כמובן, מה הגיל שלהם, מה, האם השימוש הוא, האם הם רוצים או חייבים להשתמש במוצר שלנו, האם השימוש הוא נדיר או תדיר, הוא יומיומי או שהוא קורה פעם ב. אז כל השאלות האלו יעזרו לנו בעצם לענות על ציפיית ההנאה של המשתמשים שלנו. בקארדס אגנסט יומניטי מודים לי על הגשת רעיון אידיוטי, זה משחק לאנשים איומים, וכמובן שזה מתאים פה. באסנה, אפליקציה לניהול פרויקטים, אם קינפגתי שאני מעוניינת בחיזוקים לסוף משימה, אפליקציה חוגגת איתי, מעיפים לי יוניקורן. ולגבי החוויה, אז אנחנו צריכים להכיר את החוויה, אנחנו צריכים להכיר את הרגעים המדויקים בה, ואת הרגשות של המשתמשים שלנו בתוך אותם רגעים, אם הגענו לאיזשהו רגע קשה, אנחנו מבקשים מהמשתמשים שלנו לפתוח ארנק, וקצת קשה פה, אז אם אפשר, אז למה לא בחיוך, כמו שעשו טאנלבר, תוכנת VPN, בעמוד הפרייסינג שלהם, כשהם מציעים לנו דוב קטן, ענק או מוהה, גריזלי כל יכול. ואפשר גם לוותר על הסליידר המוכר ולהשתמש באחד הומוריסטי להגברת התרומה, כמו שעשו Give a Goat ו-Turntable. איך לא לעשות את זה? בנדקמפ הוא מרקט פלייס למוזיקה עצמאית. בתרחיש המתואר פה, אני למעשה בחרתי שלא לרכוש את הטרק. באמא שלכם אין שום צורך בלבבות השבורים האלה. כל החוויה הזאת של לעשות למשתמשים שלנו רגשי, זה לא המתכון לחוויה חיובית. ועוד כלל אצבע חשוב, אל תשתמשו באותו טריק שוב ושוב, הומור זאת הפתעה. אז הומור יכול לשמש אותנו כאיזשהו אקססורי, איזה פריט קומי שמשרת איזושהי מטרה שלשמה הכנסתי אותו לממשק, אבל הוא יכול להיות גם בגדי היום יום, ממש האסטרטגיה של המוצר, הכל הייחודי שלו. אם התקנתי את פונצ'ו כאפליקציית מזג האוויר שלי, אני כנראה מעוניינת בנקודת המבט הקומית שלו על הנושא, והנה האפליקציה שואלת אותי אם אני מודאגת מבד הרדי או מהקקי של הכלב שלי. קר אותי אפליקציה לספירת קלוריות, והם לקחו את ההומור לקצה, מצליפים בי אלבונות על הגיל שלי, על טעויות השימוש שלי, על כוח הרצון העלוב שלי, עם הדלק שלכם לדיאטות, כולל שנאה עצמית מסוג זה, רוצו על זה, אני תמי אישי הוא טיפה יותר באמפתיה וחיזוקים, אבל זו הצלחה מסחרית, ורק בשביל החוויה תתקינו, ועם הצלחה קשה להתווכח. אז אני יכולה להשתמש בהומור בשביל להגביר הבנה, או לגרום למשתמשים שלי לזכור משהו, לכליל עבורם איזה רגע קשה, זה יכול להיות חלק מהקול הייחודי של המוצר שלי, אבל ההוספה מחייבת באיזשהו צידוק שימושי. באפליקציות מוטיבציה כמו רנקיפר, משתמשים באנלוגיות כמו טיל ומטוס, ויש להם באמת ערך של העצמה עבור המשתמשים שלהם. WeWork מצמידים לזימוני הפגישות שלהם, אנימייטד גיף שמתאר את הכניסה לבניין. זה נראה לכם כאילו קליל, קטן וכיפי, אבל למעשה זה ענק. הם מדווחים שמאז שהם משתמשים בטריק הזה, כמות האנשים שמגיעים אליהם בזמן לפגישות, אשכרה הכפילה את עצמם בזכות אותה למידה חבויה. ואיך לא לעשות את זה? דיסקס הוא תוסף לבעלי אתרים, לניהול פעילות גולשים. בתרחיש המתואר פה, אנחנו מנסים להסתכל פרופיל של מישהי שהגדירה את הפרופיל שלה כחסוי, ואז אנחנו חוטפים את ה-deal with it הזה, שזה איפשהו גורם לי להרגיש, אולי אני לא במקום, אולי אני מציצנית. משתמשים שלנו לא ידעו להעריך את הדחקות שלנו בדיוק ברגעים האלו ששמים אותם בפינה. אולי עדיפה פה גישת פייסבוק, אין מה להראות, פשוט אל תראו. בואו נערוז את זה רגע לאיזה מתכון מנצח לחוש ההומור ההורס של המוצר שלכם. אז context awareness, מודעות הקשר, היא תנאי הכרחי ביצירת חוויית משתמש מוצלחת, ובהקשר של הומור זה תכירו באמת את המשימה ואת כל הרגעים השונים בה, ותדעו לתפור את מהות הדבר שאתם, ההומור הזה שאתם מייצרים, כמו גם את התזמון הקומי, בדיוק למקומות הנכונים בתוך החוויה. תהיו אותנטיים, ולכו עם איזשהו קול אמיתי, לכו איתו עד הסוף. אנשים מסוגלים לפתח רגשות עבור מוצרים שמדברים אליהם בצורה שנתפסת ביניהם כאמינה, הם מסוגלים לאהוב הומור שנתפס ביניהם כאמיתי. ואמפתיה, טוב, זה טיפה טריקי, כי יש את כל אותן דוגמאות של כל סוד קסמה אירוניה וסרקזם, וגם אני הבאתי כאלה, אבל ככלל וזה נחקר, תפעלו מתוך איזו הבנה וקבלה עמוקה של הרגשות של המשתמשים שלכם, תימנעו מלתייג רגשות שליליים, ותתחנפו, זה בדוק וזה עובד. דוגמה לקונטקסט אווירנס, מתוך קוד ריסורס, מערכת רישום השעות שהצבנו בקוד ואליו, בתרחיש המתואר פה, המשתמש שלנו למעשה הזין דיווח שחרג כבר ליום הבא. אז במקום שאנחנו נזרוק לו איזושהי הודעת שגיאה או נשאל אותו האם הוא בטוח, אנחנו רק שואלים אותו, מציבים את תשומת ליבו בלהגיד לו ציפור לילה. היפמנק, אם הזמנתי מלון, ובעצם כאילו קפץ לי הקלנדר, זה קורה הרבה בדצמבר, קפץ לי הקלנדר בעצם לשנה הבאה, אז הודעת השגיאה שלהם היא Why don't you move there? אין על כנות, פיק מנקי, תחת ספר לחבריך, אנחנו פוגשים את הקופי ההורס יום שלישי בלי פחממות. ואיך לא לעשות את זה? אם נכנסתי לחנות של מודלים בתלת ממד. איפה אתם מזהים פה את ההזדמנות לתפוס עלי תחת, להגיד לי שוב ושוב שמדובר במודל ולא במציאות, סחר בנשים, לא מצחיק. אני נורא נורא מבינה את המקום הזה שלנו כאנשים יוצרים, שבעצם בוראים מוצרים, לקחת את ה... להסתכל על המוצר כאיזה קנבס לרעיונות הכי יצירתיים שלנו, ובאמת לרצות להביא את עצמנו בצורה המיטבית ביותר, אבל אנחנו חייבים לזכור שהנאה, ציפיית ההנאה היא לעולם לא שלנו, היא של המשתמשים, ואם נייצר עבורם חוויה מרחיקה, עשוי להיות לזה מחיר, עד כדי יצירה, נטישה של יצירת המופת שלנו. הנה הדוגמה האהובה עליי מכל המצגת, מיילצ'ימפ. תראו איך הם תפסו, זו דוגמה לאמפתיה, תראו איך הם תפסו בצורה כל כך מדויקת את הצורך, את הרגע המיוזה הזה, מלא האימה שלפני שליחת הניוזלטר, This is your moment of glory. טרייסי פלייל, שמעבירה סדנאות והרצאות על השימוש בהומור מהפן הפלנרי אסטרטגי, מתארת איזשהו קשר ישיר בין סוג הקומדיה שנבחר לבין עוצמת התגובה הצפויה. כלומר, אם הלכנו על הומור שהוא יותר שפיר, כמו שעשו רן קיפר, התגובה הצפויה אמורה להיות באמת יותר מאופקת, אבל אם התפרענו, כמו Cards Against Humanity, יאללה בלגן, פיפי בתחתונים. האם הומור מחייב בדיקות שמישות? אז היה ומדובר במוצר שאופיו הוא הומוריסטי, אז בוודאי ובוודאי שכן. היה ולא, חשוב שנדע לזהות את הרגעים שבהם חוש ההומור שלנו נכשל. חוקרים מצאו שלשאול משתמשים אם זה מצחיק או לא מצחיק, זה לא דרך הנכונה למדוד הומור, מאחר והומור יושב על איזשהו רצף, יותר נכון להשתמש באיזושהי סקאלה שבין לא מצחיק, מצחיק, מצחיק מאוד, ולזכור שהומור הוא הרבה פעמים רק איזשהו ממד מסייע לאיזשהו ממד מרכזי אחר, כמו זכירות, פרודוקטיביות, סיפוק. אז מה אם אתם בברזלים של המקצוע, אמונים על מערכות שהעומס הקוגניטיבי על המשתמשים שלהם הוא כל כך גדול שהומור נדמה לכם כמו איזושהי השכה לא רלוונטית. אתם יושבים פה, אני מקווה שאתם חושבים שההרצאה נחמדה, אבל אתם אומרים, מה לכל זה ולי? אז כשאנחנו מסתכלים בעולם הפיזי, ואנחנו הרי מסתכלים בעולם הפיזי, אנחנו רואים אנשים גם כשהם בעין הסערה, בעיצומה של המשימה הקריטית ביותר שלהם, משתמשים בהומור בתוך האינטראקציה הבין אישית שלהם. רופאים חותכים בזמן שהם, צוחקים בזמן שהם חותכים לאנשים עורקים. אז אולי ישנם רגעים וישנם אנשים בהם ההומור הוא בדיוק מה שכן יעזור לנו בפרודוקטיביות, מה שכן יעזור לנו לצלוח את המשימה. בעתיד הטכנולוגיה תאפשר לנו לייצר עבור המשתמשים שלנו חוויות יותר מותאמות באופן אינדיבידואלי למשתמש, ולהתאים בהקשר של הומור זה לדעת מהו הפאנץ' הנכון, בתזמון הנכון, custom made, הפתעה בשבילכם. אז עד שכל היופי הזה יקרה, תרשו לי לקוות שפשוט נדע לצחוק ולייצר הומור גם במקומות שהיום אף אחד מאיתנו לא מעז לגעת בהם. שחקו בג'וקר, אני אומרת. תודה רבה. אל תהיו זרים.
אוקיי, מזמין אותך. So, for our next talk, we're going to discuss how to turn uncertainty into creativity. Just a few more seconds before we plug in. That was nice, right? Bam! Yay! אני חושב שזה בפנים. Shifting uncertainty to creative thinking. Wow.
Wow, big title.
Okay.
Here we go. Okay. So, hello everybody. How are you? My name is Jonathan. I'm a product manager and user experience expert. I've done, over the past 10 years, I've helped to build many products in various industries, from e-commerce to social networks, messaging apps, cybersecurity products, a wide range of stuff for startups and for enterprises. I had an opportunity to experience a nice range, but most people don't know about me that before that, about 15 years ago, I started out as a full-time artist. I was a painter. I exhibited my paintings all over the not all over the world, but in some places in the world, in Brussels, in London, in Hong Kong, in the United States, here in Tel Aviv, of course. And I was pretty successful at it too. I've sold quite a few paintings, but I wasn't satisfied. I felt that I'm not making the impact that I want to make. So I turned to technology, and I decided to launch a startup without having a clue at what I'm doing. And I convinced who else but my friends and family to give me some money. Because obviously nobody wanted to give the first role to an artist. Nobody wanted to give me a job, actually. So this is why I went to create my first startup. And one of the first things we did was to hire a lawyer, right? Somebody to take care of our legal matters. And it turned out, as it often turns out with lawyers, that the bills we ended up receiving were much, much higher than what we expected. And very soon, we found out that we're about to lose all the money of our friends and our family. And I ran out to the market and tried to fix meetings and schedule meetings with anybody who was ready to talk with us. Any VC or any investor that was ready to meet me, I was there. But the answer I got from all of them, almost all of them, from 16 investors, was a constant no. And they were right in a way. It was my first time, no track record, and we didn't know the competitors well enough. We didn't know what we're getting ourselves into. But then came the crucial week that I knew that if we're not getting new money in, that's the end, it's over. There were three more investors on the pipeline that I was supposed to meet the same week. And here I want to ask you guys, what do you think I can do at that point in order to increase the chances to get a yes from one of those remaining three? So 16 times no, three more to go. What can I do at that point to increase the chances to get a yes? Come on, give me your ideas. Something different. Great. More.
Help them with something before you meet them.
Help?
Help them with something for free before you meet them.
Okay. Okay, great. Something should be different for sure. Yeah. That's nice. More. Didn't hear that? Guilt trip. That's good. Okay, great, great. An idea that I had at that point was to invite all three of them to the same place at the same time. So I rented the Hilton meeting room in Tel Aviv, and I invited all of three of them at the same place at the same time. I thought that if it would seem like there's a high demand to invest in us, that would might drive one of them to do so. And they were very surprised, and at that point I didn't need to do anything different because I didn't need to talk at all. They just spoke to each other, and we got a yes at the end. But I'm not telling you this story because of that. I'm telling you this story because it sent me on a research, on a mission that took me about 10 years and still no answers, no final answers. And this is the question. Why didn't I see it before? Why did I need to get 16 times no in order for the brain, which is the same brain, to give me my winning solution? And this blew my mind. So I started to look deeper into it. Why there are some moments that our brain gives us its best, but other moments when we need it also, we don't get it. We don't get the maximum capacity of our brain all the time. How can it be? So let's look at some examples. In the late 1980s, two struggling comedians wanted to create a comedy show, right? And we all know this comedy show. They started out, they wanted to create a 90-minute show and about how comedians write jokes. But then, only then, when they ran out into a dead end, they actually came up with a concept of a 10-minute turnaround. They came up with the concept of a show about nothing, which became Seinfeld. Or let's look at Samsung. You probably are wondering why I'm saying Samsung and showing noodles, but Samsung started out as a noodles company. It was only after the company assets were buried under the ashes of the Korean War that they reinvented themselves as the company we know today. Southwest Airlines, they were losing money. And it was only at that point that they were struggling to survive that they came up with a concept that they called the 10-minute turnaround, which meant that the plane had to land, prepare the plane, onboard new passengers, all in 10 minutes, 10 minutes only. And this actually gave the shift and that helped them become the most successful low-cost airline today in the United States. The Instagram founders, they started out with a different product called Bourbon. And it was only after they launched the product that they realized that nobody was uploading photos, that nobody was checking in like they were supposed to do. People were just uploading photos like crazy. And that's how they came across the concept of Instagram. And I heard Kevin Systrom say in one podcast, something that I brought for you because it demonstrates my point. He said, initially, our bet was on location, but I'm just very happy we discovered this image thing along the way. Wow, you know, we often hear these kind of sentences from successful founders, and we're like, wow, what a lucky guy. You know, he just billion-dollar ideas just drop into his head effortlessly. You know, he probably meditates every morning, and this kind of guy, it just happens to him. And I think that looking at it that way is misleading, because we start to think, okay, what do we need to do in order to get just a tiny bit of his luck? So first thing we do is sticky notes, right? We need to show we were thinking and being creative. So we fill the room floor to ceiling with sticky notes. And if we go to Google and we Google brainstorming, then we get tons of sticky notes and tons of sketches. And this is what we do. But then it's very hard to converge from that. It's easy to put out ideas. It's very hard to narrow down. So then we say, okay, no, we need to do a completely different activity. We probably need to do something more that will come from deep from our souls, something artistic. Let's bring a canvas and start to paint. And maybe doing this activity, which is different, the miracle will happen. But it doesn't work either. And then we say, okay, I know what's the problem. The office is the problem, okay? The walls are the problem. That's why we're not getting our best ideas. So we need an offsite. And I've actually been in an offsite that they took us to the Jordan River and we had to float on surfboards and brainstorm while we were doing that. Okay, and guess what? People just fell in the water. Nothing happened. So what interests me in this sentence, what gets my attention is actually this part. Along the way. The actual work we put in along the way, along the process, might be that the work itself is the most powerful mechanism of all those mechanisms and all those tools that we read every day in blog posts and whatnot. Work itself, because if Seinfeld would not have to work and rework the script, they wouldn't come up with a concept of a show about nothing. If Samsung wouldn't have to work their way out of a crisis, they would probably not reinvent themselves as the company we know today. Southwest Airlines had to work hard to survive, and only then the spark came. And same with Instagram, right? You know how hard it is to understand how users are actually using your product. So that's when it came for them. And it's not only them. Research says that 70% of successful companies today ended up succeeding with something they didn't originally start with. This is an amazing thing. Okay, they started out with one thing and ended up succeeding with something they came up with along the way. But it's not just work. It's not just how much we work. It's actually how we work. Because if we look at the common conditions they all faced and describe it with one word and one word only, that would be uncertainty. So the question is this: what if feeling uncertain is not an obstacle like it actually feels? What if it's actually an accelerator that helps us to reach our best potential, our best thinking potential, our best ideas, our best solutions? And I believe there is something to it. And what if we can take it one step further? What if we could control it and generate it in our daily work? Because usually, and luckily, we don't confront such extreme situations in our daily work, right? So what if we could simulate and make our brains think that now is the time? Now is the time, give me your best idea right now, okay? And today, what I like to do is to share three tactics with you in order to bring our certainty into our work. We understand that uncertainty is good, but there's still a very, very big problem. And the problem is that every inch of our body, every inch of our mind is fighting for the complete opposite, right? We want certainty. We want the familiar. And it makes sense because once we figure out how to do something, we lose interest in improving. Okay, we go from zero to one and okay, now I know how to do it. So what we really need is we need habits to push us into uncertainty on purpose, because otherwise we don't go there. And we understand that we want to be there. We want to take as many decisions as possible from this state of mind, from this emotional state. I wrote a book about this. It's called The Other Ideas. And I published it a year ago, but no worries, I'm going to tell you all about it. Nobody's going to have to read anything. So three habits I'd like to share with you to bring uncertainty into our daily work in order to accelerate our brain power. So the first one would be to limit your superpower. But wait a minute. What's a superpower and how can I limit it? So our superpower is this one thing we all have that we can do in the middle of the night with our hands behind our backs. Okay, something that brought us until this point. And it can be something very, superpower is a fancy word, but it can be something very, it doesn't need to be fancy, it can be very modest. It can be as creating a spreadsheet, it can be making a presentation, it can be creating a marketing slogan, it can be creating humor in a product, anything that comes natural to us that we've been doing for a long time. And the catch is that when I ask most people, when did you make a big leap in this area of yours? Most people tell me a long time ago. So what's happening here? The thing we're very good at is the same thing we're afraid to touch, right? Because if we know that people applaud each time we do it, then why change? Okay, we're afraid to change it. And I've seen colleagues that were afraid to make this leap in this area that they're so good at and gradually went out of the game and lost very meaningful opportunities. So think about it. What is it for you? What's this one thing for you that you're good at and you avoid taking a big leap in? For me, for example, it's wireframing. And I've been doing this for many years. So what I do today is actually I limit this superpower. I force myself to use only two or three templates, even if 50 or 60 templates are needed. So even somebody very experienced says, oh, that's why did I get myself into this project? So that does it for me in this area. But there are many more examples. A very talented designer who attended one of my workshops, his superpower is to create amazing illustrations with vibrant colors and really eye-catching. And he decided to limit this superpower of his and to use only one color. Okay, one color only. And he called me up and he told me that because he needed to create a beautiful illustration with one color, it took him to a completely new design language. Or an HR partner I worked with, she after 20 years, she stopped reading CVs before going into an interview. Okay, and then she was amazed how her brain comes up with new questions to understand who is sitting in front of her. So it's a very powerful thing. And her superpower doesn't need to be a skill. It can also be a resource. If we look at Wikipedia, for example, ironically, their very best feature, which became their scalability engine, the fact that each and every one of us can edit anything in Wikipedia anytime, wasn't just an idea that popped into a genius CEO's mind. Actually, this CEO tells a different story. He says that this idea came up because they simply didn't have money. They couldn't hire professional editors, so the uncertainty it brought led them to engage the community, which gave them the power and the scalability they have today. You see, there is a very interesting relationship between the resources we have and the uncertainty we need to face. Because the more resources we have, the less uncertainty we need to face, right? We have everything, time and money, endless. But since we understand that creativity is inside uncertainty, what this graph really means is that when resources go down, creativity goes up. And this is exactly the essence of what we want to do here with limiting our superpowers. There are research made in recent years that show that most of the time we're not thinking. We're on autopilot. They scanned people's brains and they see zero activity for 95% of the time. The trigger that tells the brain to switch on is when we are confronted with new information. But it doesn't happen often enough. So we need to make sure we confront ourselves with new information and improvise, give ourselves a chance to improvise our way out. And this is what we want to do with this habit. And before I go to my second one, I want to talk about Miles Davis. Miles Davis, you know him? Anybody like jazz?
Yeah.
Okay, great trumpeter. Anybody who likes jazz admires Miles Davis. In 1959, he recorded an album called Kind of Blue, a flagship album in the world of jazz. Let's listen to the first piece and then we'll talk about it. 20 seconds. Nice, right? What most people don't know is that it was supposed to sound completely different. The entrance of the drummer needed to be so smooth, and actually the cymbal was barely supposed to be heard. And also, the drummer came in too early, so there was a mistake there. So what do we see musicians do when this kind of stuff happens? They say, well, that's in jazz, maybe. But not always. It's a recording. Usually they say, no, roll it back. Give it to me the way I want it, the way I imagined it. But what Miles Davis did, he burst in with a trumpet solo that was supposed to start completely different. Okay, now let's listen to it again and I'll show you a signal when the drummer comes in. Okay, ready? Right now. Okay, so you can maybe hear how things go out of sync and go back into sync again. And when Miles Davis was interviewed about this, so he had a great sentence. They asked him, why didn't you want to record it again? And he said, it all comes with it. Okay, it all comes with it. He understands that the best things happened along the way, right? Let's look at a completely different example from a different field. Anybody like Chef's Table? Yeah, now there's a new season. So Massimo Bottura, Italian chef. Let's hear how he describes how he invented the dessert that he got 3 Michelin stars for. Let's listen.
Ready to serve the dessert. So Taka, that you know, he prepared 2 lemon tart for the service. At the moment the service was ready, he dropped one of the 2. and it broke one of the two on the counter. And Taka was like, as a good Japanese, he was ready to kill himself. I said, Taka, no, Taka is so beautiful. Don't you see? With the, you know, the zabayon just made, you know, was splash proper. And so I said, look, Taka, look, look at this, look at this. This is just perfect. So what we did, we rebuilt the same situation in another plate with all the same elements that was on the top of the lemon tart. And we rebuilt the same tart that we dropped on another plate. And we create the same situation in the two plates that were ready to serve.
All right. So what are these guys doing? Two people from completely different industries. What are they doing? Improvising and adopting mistakes and unexpected events that happened along the way.
Where?
So this leads me to my second habit that I want to share with you. And I call it to catch meta moments. What are meta moments? I'll say in a minute. Let's go a minute and see what's the workflow we usually do. So we used to produce something and get something in return. Okay, we used to deliver a design to our developer and then have it developed as we designed it. Well, there are many things that it's not so easy usually, but this is what we're used to. We are a machine. Okay, same old thinking, same old results. Same old thinking, same old results. But every once in a while, we can't control it. Something unexpected happens. And what do we do then? Our instinct is to say, no, no, no. Can you fix it, please? But if we, at that moment, there is a lot of potential. If we take a step back and ask ourselves the following question. What can be the most natural step from this point on? Forget what it should have been. What can this be? So then we get a new fresh ideas, a new wind of fresh ideas coming into our brains. This enables uncertainty to come into our work process. And then unexpected thinking comes, which leads to more unexpected results. So actually, this mistake was not a mistake. It's a golden bridge to pass from a certain mindset to an uncertain mindset. We just need to catch it. And in research language, they call this moment meta moments. They understand that there is a lot of power in this moment. And the meta moment is defined by the gap between the trigger and our action. And usually we pass by through it as if it doesn't exist. But there is a moment, okay? We're triggered and then we immediately react. But what happens there in the middle? If we stop and ask ourselves, what just happened here? What do I see? You remember this movement that Massimo Bottura did like this? Okay, forget what's outside the picture. What do I see? Then you might see unexpected beauty and unexpected opportunity that will lead you to unexpected thinking. And this is where the magic happens. For example, Pixar, they understand this. So what they do, they change the team members during the production of a movie. So a certain team starts and then they change the team members and then they take it from there. Because they understand two things, that best ideas come along the way, and the second, that it's very hard for us to do it. Okay, it's very hard for us to detach ourselves from what we wanted initially. So obviously we're not Pixar and we can't change our team members. But what we can do, we can think, if we were this new team member, what would we think about this work in front of us? Forget about what it should have been. What's the most natural action to do from this state and forward? And many times, it makes the magic. Now, if you think, if you do this exercise and then you test some options and you decide to go with the original plan, that's totally fine. But it would be from a completely different angle. It would be after you learned something, after you entertained various options and re-chose your original option. So you would come back to it differently. So we can't control what happens, but we can control how we react. And this is where we want to focus on. Our third and final habit, tactic. You know this guy? Anybody like South Park? Yeah? You remember his name? Yeah, Captain Hindsight. Let's take a look at 2 minutes. Even less.
Captain Hindsight! Captain Hindsight, thank God you've come!
What's the skinny?
There's people trapped in that burning building, Captain Hindsight! And the fire is so massive we can't get to them! You see those windows on the right side? They should have built fire escapes on those windows for the higher floors, then people could have gotten down. And then on the roof, they should have built it with a more reinforced structure so a helicopter could have landed on it. Yes, of course! And then you see that building to the left? Yes! They shouldn't have built that there, because now you can't park any fire trucks where you really need to. Well, looks like my job here is done. Goodbye, everyone! Thank you, Captain Hindsight!
You know this guy at work? There's always a Captain Hindsight in the room, right? When things go bad, there's always somebody who says, oh, right, the color should have been different. Or, oh, no, the call to action should have been completely, I told you. So we obviously never want to be this person. But this element, this principle does have a lot of power if we use it before things go bad. And this is when I want to talk about thinking backwards. You know these moments in the room that everybody is certain that what we're going to do now is the right thing to do? These are the most dangerous moments ever. Okay, if there's no doubts, no questions, this is certain mindset at its best. So this is when a red bulb should light in your head. Okay, so when you say, yeah, this is the best thing to do now, this would bring us where we want to be. No, that's a problem. Okay, we need to be constantly asking questions and being in doubt. That might, and if we're feeling that way, there's an overconfidence in the room. And it happens to us a lot. We're overconfident by default. So it's kind of like a solving a maze from the end to the beginning. This principle is about is to actually imagine that our project has already failed and analyze what might be the reason why. Okay? What this does is it creates a crack in our confidence, which is usually overboosted, and enables uncertainty to enter our mindset. Okay? What if this fails? What might be the reason why? And then all of a sudden, it's not like you become a genius in 1 minute, but you do see more details that you haven't seen before. Okay? We ignore a lot of stuff that we're seeing. So once we ask this question, we start to see more details. So I want to share with you one time that this was extremely powerful and extremely helpful. I had a project that I made with an e-commerce company, and they have a famous product that is already successful globally. And we worked 10 months on a redesign, a complete UX redesign for the entire product. And towards the end, towards the final meetings, they brought advisors from abroad and very smart people and very talented. And towards one of the final meetings, I asked the group to do this exercise. Let's imagine we launched the new design and it failed. What might be the reason why? And the head of user experience stood up and he said, it might fail because the registration form is just too long. Wow, silence in the room. We were embarrassed. You know, so many people, 10 months, all the features inside and so excited about it, but not even realizing the door is locked. Nobody can come in. There were more than 10 fields in the registration form. And what this led us to do is to think about a completely new approach. We removed the registration altogether, and we created an experience where people could jump right in and use the product. And while they were engaging, we triggered just small questions. Do you want to know when somebody replies to your comment? Just give us your email. A week later, why don't you add a username? A couple of days later, in the right context, why don't you upload a photo? And we were creating the user profile gradually as people were using the product. Now, it's pretty funny to think that we worked on it for 10 months and what they wrote on in TechCrunch and all the blog and all the tech blogs was about this. Okay, this ended up being the innovation of this entire redesign. And it just came at the end using this question. Imagine we failed, and let's think backwards and see what we can do differently. Krishnamurti, the Indian philosopher, he has a sentence that says, a confident man is a dead man. And I say, a confident brain is a dead brain. So what we want to do here is break the confidence, controlled slightly, in order to let uncertainty come in the process. And all of a sudden, we see new options. You know, this entire uncertainty thing is not my invention. People have been using it for a very long time. David Bowie, his superpower is to write songs, right? But he knows that in order to write a genius David Bowie song, he needs to put himself in places he hasn't been before and create tension. So he imposes a hardship on himself to reduce resources in order to be more creative. Donna Tartt, an amazing American author, she wrote The Goldfinch, which is an amazing book. She says she doesn't know even what the story is. She discovers the story along the way. She discovers her winning features along the way. She just goes along with it. You know, there are so many tools that are being discussed. I'm starting to wrap up. And there are endless methodologies and tools and trends. And they all discuss about tools, but nobody is discussing, or not enough people are discussing, what do we feel when we work? Because we might use the best tool, but if we're not in the right emotional state, if we don't know how to deal with uncertainty and to catch these special moments, we will not get the best potential out of those tools. So how do we feel when we work? And if there's one thing I want you to take from today, is that next time you feel this burning feeling in your stomach that we try to avoid so much, just remember this one thing, that uncertainty is creativity. We've been misinterpreting this feeling as something negative, but it's not. It's actually a green light telling us you are in a zone of potential. Now is your time to shine, right now. So this is actually, uncertainty is actually how creativity feels. And if we're not there, we're probably on autopilot. Now I know it's not easy, and in many times it's counterintuitive. But if we'll be able to limit our superpower in order to enable ourselves to improvise our way out, if we will be quick enough to catch those meta moments and brave enough to think backwards and to imagine even a potential failure and see what we can do differently, then we can create for ourselves new circumstances that enable us to be even more creative. Thank you.
Thank you. Wow, okay, that was great. So Yonatan was a speaker in the last UXLon conference, and I'm hearing this again and again. I'm amazed by this conference. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you, Al. So we have 15 minutes, Yonatan. I want to ask the crowd, does anyone have something to say or ask, either you or your L? Or maybe you have a question for the audience.
What's your superpower?
Yael, come on stage, Yael. Okay. Go for it.
handling death with humor. How do we do it? Well,
I'll give an example.
Like, okay.
Your product is about death?
Come up.
I was toying with an option of writing my will or will of testament or creating an app for it, but it's all about death eventually. So how do you get humor into such a situation?
Well, who is the user?
Well, anyone who wants to think about their own death.
Okay.
So making light of a darker situation, I think it's...
Yeah. So potentially, you know, for some user it might work, for some less. So it depends on how you built your product and what your, like, what is the voice and tone of this persona of a product. Like, you can aim for people who wants to do it in a humorous
way. So there's a question here. If we do this, I mean, it seems like it's the right thing to do, to use humor in a very, very grim situation. We know we're all going to get there. So maybe a humorous interface would make it more light, this very, very heavy thing. But is it going to impact people's confidence in the product, humor in that sense?
So.
People need to be assured that this is going to be a good interface, that they can trust, that it could create.
So you might spot the certain places in which you can use humor and think about all the legal things that you are about to deal with that are not humorous, that it would not be such a great idea to use humor in. So it depends. It really depends on the places in the journey of the user.
Okay. Any more questions? Okay, there's two questions here. Yeah. I'm repeating the question.
Yeah.
Some brands should stay away from humor?
So I would say no. I would say that it really depends. The nature of the humor that you are using supposed to be suitable for your brand. So, for example, I work in Philips Healthcare. It's not a place in which we tend to make jokes. So, but I do find places in which I can use humor, but it's not the kind of humor that while watching Seinfeld you experience. So it's like empty states. Like, there are moments in every product that humor is something that you may consider use in the right nature of it.
Okay. One more question. Yes, here. Cultural differences in humor.
Yeah, there are, of course. I mean, can you give an example? There are. It's not that I'm a comedian making UX, right? So I do UX for a living, and it's not that at every project that I do I find a place to make humor, but there are repeat the question again. Sorry.
Cultural differences.
So, in the materials that I read, for example, that I know that for the Japanese market, you cannot label feelings when regarding this audience. So there are, of course, there are cultural differences.
Okay. I wonder, Jonathan, or does anyone heard Jonathan's talking? It touches a nerve. Does anyone have the same problems? Yes.
Repeat the question. Having them confide in uncertainty when they
Yeah, that's a good question. So you're asking how to convince stakeholders and higher management to adopt uncertainty. That's what you're asking? Okay, that's a good one. I think that since, you know what, uncertainty is something, it's a feeling, right? It's something we feel. And most of the time we can be busy all day in meetings, but then it all narrows down to a very private moment that we're sitting with our laptop, right? And taking decisions. You know, the work, actually the actual work, we don't do it out in the spotlights. We do it in the backstage. You know, that's where we work. So I think that it's relevant more to our own work process and what's guiding our decisions, how aware of what we're feeling in relation to what we're doing. Okay? And so I think this is where this is going more. And then, you know, each manager for himself, when they take decisions, they might be better off if they know how to endure it more. Because the more time you're able to endure uncertainty, then you're entertaining more options for more time. So you're allowing more things to rise up. So I think it narrows down to when we work, it's a very private moment. What we think affects what we do, and what we do is actually who we are and what we present. I hope, okay. did it answer your
Thank
question?
You.
All right.
There's more questions. By the way, don't forget, I just posted the Instagram photo. Don't forget to tell me what you want. There's already like nice comments there. In the meantime, so yes, more over there. Practical advice for uncertainty.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'll repeat the question. You're asking about a practical advice for a product manager on dealing better with uncertainty. Okay. You know, there are two types of product managers usually that I meet. There are some people who need to have everything all sorted out and then they go on the mission. And some people can just shoot in the dark and are better at this kind of stuff. It's a lot about personality. You know, it's a lot about for some people it's just easier to manage uncertainty, and some people just avoid dealing with it altogether. So first of all, I think that these three habits might be effective also for a product manager. But in terms of a more specific advice, maybe, you know, sometimes as product manager, we try to gather all the information beforehand. And only then we say, okay, now I have all the ammunition I need and I'm ready to go out. But we can even start when we have holes in the story and actually know that these situations are opportunities for to do even better work. They're opportunities for us to show that we're the kind of people that are able to deal with such complex situations. So once you start to have fun with it, it shifts your perspective. So I think my practical advice would be to have fun with it. Okay?
All right. So anyone who wants to share something, interesting thing that they thought about, something that inspired them, not just a question. Yes, come up. Yeah, it's you. Yeah, why not? Let everyone. Because you're so far in the back. Yes, okay. Sure, come up, yay.
Okay, here we go.
This is the salon, okay.
If this is the salon, where is the couch? Where's the coffee table?
Got it.
I wanted to say that your speech, like, I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. Like everything you were saying was like very Marageshwati. For many, many different reasons. I could talk for an hour, but I'm not one of the speakers, so I won't. So I studied architecture originally. And in architecture, I did this specific course in avant-garde architecture in California at one of like the craziest schools in America called SciArch. If you look up SciArch, you won't understand the buildings. They don't look like buildings. They look like blobs. Like, it's just very like futuristic. And the whole point of the thing, they would give you the weirdest assignments. Take popsicle sticks and create an interdimensional structure that blah, blah, blah. Like, you wouldn't even understand the assignment. And they would give you the assignment at 6 o'clock at night, and it was due at 8 in the morning. So you were there until like 4 in the morning with popsicle sticks and hot glue guns and trying to figure out what they wanted. And every single time, we would get stuck. Every single time. And then you'd have to start again and again. But then you'd have an idea that you never would have had if you'd had the idea at the beginning. It's exactly like what you were saying. I was like, oh my God, that was what was happening. They were deliberately torturing us to make us have ideas. And like, because, you know, obviously you're like, well, if I know what I knew at the beginning, this would have taken me an hour to create instead of like the 20-hour process that was so painful and it was awful and you start crying and it was, you know, you don't get to sleep that night. You have to go back to, you know, but it just was like amazing. And so also just for me as a perfectionist, I hate starting and knowing I'm going to mess up. I hate it. But what you're saying is start anyways. You will mess up. And actually, it's good to mess up. And when you mess up, you can redirect yourself to something that's even better than what you thought you were going to mess up about, you know?
Definitely.
So yeah. Thank you. I was very excited. Thank you so much.
Wow, that was great. Okay, guys, that's it. We're out of time. Thank you all for coming. I hope to see you in the conference. It's just in 15 days from now. So see you soon. Bye. Thanks for coming. Your comment was great.
Was it? It was like a little bit too.